Hello, everyone, and welcome to this live broadcast from True Fire Studios. You see who's on the screen. It's Josh Smith. He's back in the studio this week. Just finished up two courses. We're going to tell you all about them. And this go-round, we are going to try to get in as much playing as possible, which I think serves both of the new courses really well. So listen, without further ado, and if you want a little more background on Josh, go tune in the first live broadcast we did. It's in our YouTube channel. It's on True Fire. But let's get busy. Let's interrupt the man right now. He's wearing his Yankees hat. We'll tell you why in a second. Hey, man, how you doing?
What's happening?
You're back. You're back. We did two this time, didn't we?
We did. We knocked out a lot of stuff.
Oh, my God. I probably shouldn't say this, but I've already started to say it, so I'll say it, okay? Josh broke a record here in the studio. He finished off two courses, and we're talking about there is a lot of content. Tommy, how many hours do we have in Improv Roadmap?
I would say about three and a half hours.
We've got 3 or 3.5 hours of unbelievable lesson content and performance study content in Blue Highways, the Improv Roadmap edition of that, which people have been asking for. You were kind enough to come back and do it for them. So they're going to be excited to hear about that. And then we did an In the Jam with 10 tracks, backing tracks that really represent what you play when you're on stage, right?
Yeah, I think it's a good cross-section of the styles of tunes that I do in my thing, you know.
Yeah,
A little bit of everything. Yeah. Sounds like my gig kind of.
Exactly. So if you've ever been to one of Josh's shows and you had that, like you just wanted to get up on the stage and get in the jam with them, this is as close as you'll get.
Yeah, I'll play rhythm for you all night long.
I know. So I really want us to try to cover as much playing ground as possible, but a little bit of housekeeping. First off, thank you, everybody, for chiming in. Let us know where you're tuned in from, and we'll shout out to you. It's always fun to see where everyone's tuned in from, time zone, continents, what have you. Secondly, we have you can win a $100 True Fire gift card if you can answer this trivia question. What was the name of Josh's band when he was 13 years old? Okay. The name of Josh's band when he was 13 years old. Do not post it in the chat. Don't do that because then you're going to give the answer away. There's a link, right there. They just posted it. Click on that link. Answer that question. We'll pick a winner at the end of this. And the other bit of housekeeping is questions, man. What we want to try to do is a lot of playing. Josh loves to answer questions. Load us up, and we're going to try to get to every single one of them.
Yeah.
Finally, you see that little thumbs up button? If you help us, well, number one, that's sharing your love and spreading the love. We'd love to get to 100 during this broadcast. And if you help us get to 100, we will force Josh to play one extra bonus tune. One of my favorite performances, actually. But you got to get us to 100. All right. Let's start, Josh, with the first course, which is the Improv Roadmaps edition of Blue Highways. What's an improv roadmap?
Oh, okay. So to me, improvisation is the most fun that you can have, you know, as a musician, at least for where I'm coming from. I've spent my life building up, you know, a vocabulary, a toolbox full of how to play in all situations. Drop me down on a stage in any style of music and point at me and it's your turn to go or whatever, I'm going to go. You know, no matter how confident I am or what I am, you know, what the situation is, I'm going to play like I belong there and something's going to come out and I'll be okay. And that comes from, you know, a lifetime of building up this like improvisational whatever, grab bag. Uh-huh. So the roadmap is a way for everybody to start building up their vocabulary and find, you know, this sounds silly, but it's important to me to find their like personal and honest solo. I look at every improvisational solo as a chance to kind of put together everything. So that means all that knowledge that you have in your head, everything you're thinking about, all that heart and soul that you got here in your phrasing and in your feeling, and how to balance that all together and play really, really what is right for you to play at that moment. And it's different for everybody, but I think I've come up with ways to help people find their thing. And yes, that's what this course is really about.
Yeah. What I love about this course is, look, there's no doubt you're going to find the playing to be, let's call it, advanced. I think that would be a very fair statement, okay? And, you know, we mere mortal players, you know, we're not going to be able to nail the entire solo. Yes, you'll be able to pull out lots of phrases, lots of licks, but I think the key learning here, we were talking about the level of play.
Yeah.
And Josh, you know, made a really good point, which is even a beginner will benefit from this course because it's more of a mindset for how to approach soloing.
Absolutely, because yes, you'll get, you know, me talking about actual licks and, you know, I'll explain actual ideas and you'll get, of course, the tab of everything I'm playing. So that's all there for you. But it's more about why did I play that there? What are the influences and the determining factors that led me down this path in my improvisation? Because even though we're making this up on the fly, that's what improvisation is, you know, there's certain things that happen that always affect an improvisation in the same way. If a drummer plays a certain thing, I'm going to react. If the level on stage rises, I'm going to react, and it's going to change my improvisation. If I look out and there's a room full of people in the proverbial dive bar, and they're all watching the game on TV instead of watching me, I'm going to play angry, or I'm going to play something to get their attention. Uh-huh. There's all these things that factor. It's not just the vocabulary you have, the technique you have. All those things equally come into the pot. The tone you use, it all influences what comes out at that moment when it's your turn to improv. And I think I'm helping, you know, every one of those tools get sharpened pretty much, where the end goal is that you tell a story that's your personal story, and yeah, it really truly reflects how you're feeling and what you're trying to say on the instrument.
Yeah, and you know, your first course, Blue Highways, which went, you know, as they said back in the days of radio, number one with a bullet, and it's still in the top 10, you know. Blue Highways really kind of explored, it was a masterclass that explored a lot of the things that make you horizontally. We did a live broadcast. Folks loved it. And they wanted us to dive a little deeper in this particular area, improv roadmap.
Yeah.
And you absolutely delivered. So listen, let's give them an example. Let's roll that B.B. King track.
Okay.
And you talked about, you know, building your vocabulary and phrasing. Okay.
Yeah.
So just talk a little bit about that and then let's play.
So obviously one of the biggest pieces of the pie in learning to build a solo is, well, what vocabulary do you have to start with, to draw from when you're taking the solo? So you obviously build up, number one, a lot of knowledge. What to play on what chord, what to play in what styles, what fits. That's, you got to have that stuff. And you have to be so comfortable with it that that is almost not a thought at all. You're on complete autopilot. A song starts, a chord comes up in the song. You know what to play over that chord. You know what works in that chord. So you can worry about actually getting across what you're thinking. Well, but first you have to get that vocabulary so built in. And then the phrasing of that vocabulary is how you start to say what you're trying to say in the quickest way between point A and point B as possible. Mm. Directly get this idea across. So it may be you want to say this by holding a note for a while, or you want to repeat this phrase a few times, because this phrase really, really tells you, or tells the audience, what you're trying to convey. So you're going to hammer that phrase home. You may change it around a little bit. You may do this, you may do that. But these are the kind of tools that you can use to work on phrasing. You take that vocabulary you've worked really hard on, and then you start to learn where to play the right things. And so I'll play this B.B. King shuffle, and I'll do a lot of thematic playing. I'll start with a theme. I'll expand on the theme, and I'll keep referencing it as we go.
Awesome. Tommy, roll it. We'll be right back. When you talk about roadmaps too, I love how you think about it like you're telling a story. And I will tell everybody here, while we are using the tracks, you're hearing the actual tracks that will come with the course. And that you will never hear Josh play the same thing the same way twice. It just doesn't happen.
Yeah, but yet everything I played probably sounds composed or familiar.
Mm-hmm.
And that's because I've built up, you know, a conversational style to my playing where a big part of it is, okay, the song starts, I get the groove in my head. The first thing I play automatically becomes the guidepost, the roadmap for the entire solo.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like it lays itself out for me. It's ready there for me to just, you know, paint by numbers and fill it in, you know. But it's all laid out right there. That lick happens and then... So automatically I'm hearing bam 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 ba dam bam bam as an answer to that lick, you know? And that's the way I think about this stuff. You build this solo in a way that people can't help but relate to this solo. It's much different than just throwing stuff at the wall and hoping that it sticks. Not that there's any, you know, when a guy comes up on stage and plays that same shuffle and just goes there's nothing wrong with any of that.
Mm-hmm.
No wrong notes, no nothing that's a problem, but there's no theme there. There's nothing that makes the non-musician in the audience turn their head or start tapping their head or tapping their foot, as opposed to if you go... automatically telling a story.
Mm-hmm.
And like you said, it is much like telling a story. It's like writing a letter. It's like having a beginning, introduction, having a middle, having an ending. You've got to give the audience that if you expect them to connect with what you're trying to say.
Exactly. And this really relates to what we were talking about just before that performance, which is even if you're a beginner, there's a great lesson here. So Josh is basically saying you have to develop a vocabulary. But you don't have to have a massive, extensive vocabulary. Doesn't even have to be blazing licks. But once you have the vocabulary, the next level is about telling a story without vocabulary.
Yeah, whatever vocabulary you have in your toolbox or in your back pocket, utilize it to the best of your ability to tell your story.
Mm-hmm.
That's the main key is you're trying to say something. You should always be trying to say something in an improvisation. It shouldn't be just about playing everything I can play or impressing somebody or just playing for the sake of playing. No, you're trying to play, convey how you're feeling and what you really hear over this moment of music, whatever that is.
Yeah.
So that's the goal, is to make your point.
Exactly. And what's really interesting, and somebody picked up on it, right, in chat, it's, you know, if you rewind a little bit, someone said, you know, when you hear Josh play, you know it's Josh. You could just hear Josh there. So while he's got a vocabulary, once he starts to tell a story, even though every story is going to sound a little different, you're going to know it's him, just like you know somebody that you're familiar with. You know their speech pattern. You know how they talk. You know how they interact, you know?
Well, it's like, you know, this is a word I throw out a lot, and people don't often think about it in music, but it's honesty. You're trying to be honest in your improvisation. I feel like the audience knows if I play something that's out of character or something that I'm trying, like, you know, if there's a room full of guitar players out there, maybe ones who I'm fans of, if I play something completely out of character that's flashy just for the sake of being flashy to get them to react, then that's not completely honest.
Yeah.
There's a difference between doing that and playing truly, truly what you're hearing and what you're feeling and balancing that out. And I think any audience member knows the difference between a guy going through the motions or with an agenda and a guy who's just an open conduit and playing truly what he feels.
Yeah, you know, that is, man, that actually is a very honest statement, because we've watched, as I'm sure a lot of the audience did, a lot of YouTube videos of you. And you play, there's a lot of videos of you playing with, you know, some of the best guitar players, you know, in the world, sure, on the stage at the same time. And you never go for that flashy, let me impress or outdo that guy. You're always Josh Smith, you know?
Well,
that's the beauty of what you do.
I'm, you know, it's silly. As a guitar player, there's a weird gray area for guitar players, especially as an improviser, because it takes a small amount of ego to get on stage and play, and then to have people judge what you do, you know, because you got to be confident at least that you can put your point across and do your thing. But, yeah, I'm very cognizant of the fact that I'm not up there just to blow smoke up my own butt or to get people, you know, excited about a certain lick or a thing. I'm up there because this is what I'm supposed to be doing. Mm-hmm. I'm meant to play. I'm meant to improvise over this music. Nothing makes me happier. So I want to be shut off. I want to be on the stage not thinking about anything other than playing this music. Mm-hmm. I just want to be in the moment and playing.
Well said, man. Let's play right here, right now.
All right.
How about talk a little bit about the lesson on time and doing the math? And then demonstrate that for us.
So we're going to do a more straight groove right here instead of a shuffle. This is like a straight eighth note pop type, or almost Motown-y, but not a four on the floor groove in A. And I'm going to focus on taking licks and moving around in time and breaking up the beat, taking licks that cross the bar line, which is a very important thing, especially when you move between chords. When you cross between the bar line and then resolve, you get this, you know, great moment of tension and release, even if it's not harmonically tension or dissonant or anything like that. Just messing with time that way gives people a release. And then by doing the math, I mean, we are all born with this internal clock, you know? Some people's clock are better than others, but we're all able to start getting this, you know, that vocabulary that we've worked on. You also can play that same lick 800 million ways, and you learn how to, in your head, break up this lick in a bar of music, or in two bars of music, or in three bars of music. You may swing it and play it with dotted eighths. You may play it way behind the beat. You may put it right on top of the beat. You may double time that lick. You may play it in 32nd notes, you know? So doing the math is kind of, you find a way to fill in that bar. It may be two quarter notes and then a couple of 16th notes and then the 32nd notes, you know, you may do, or a swung triplet to end the phrase. You build up this muscle memory of how to play all this stuff and just make it fit. It just happens. So I'm going to play a lot of repeating licks, but move them around in time, and then play a lot of stuff that goes over the bar line.
Cool. Tommy?
Thank you.
Good demonstration, man.
Well, I mean, you want to take those licks and be able to, you know, change them in time.
So, and, you know, even if a player had a vocabulary of 12 licks, that could be, you know, 12 times 12, right? 12 times 120 different ways to play.
It's never any. You could take this bar of music and go, you know. I'm going to swing it. I'm going to break it up in a lot of different ways, you know, and do it all in the same bar, you know, change feels. It's all another part of the toolbox that's helping you express what you're trying to get across.
That's, and listen, another great, I know I keep reiterating this, but it really is, it's really true. And I want everyone to accept that. I mean, you'll hear the performances and of course, you know, everyone loves to judge a course by the cool playing they hear on it, right?
Sure.
But the real value, I think, of Improv Roadmaps, this Improv Roadmaps edition of Blue Highways, are these broad stroke key learnings, man, because you can make a lot of music with the six blues licks that you know. And
absolutely,
you just need someone to tell you how to approach doing that, you know?
Well, yeah, there's nobody I'd rather listen to than Albert King. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he played five notes, basically.
Right, that's right.
You know, but I'd still rather listen to him improvise than anybody else on the face of the earth.
He told a story every time he played, didn't he?
Every single time.
Yeah. So listen, you want to shout out to some of your fans? I'll tell you where they're tuned in from.
Yes, please.
We have Utah, Yorkshire, Western PA, Arkansas, Argentina, Roswell, New Mexico. Hey, Area 51, I think there was some kind of... thing happening
it.
There recently. Montreal, Atlanta, New Hampshire, Harlem in the Netherlands, Sao Paulo,
in the Netherlands.
Brazil, California, Norway, Germany, Rome, Brazil, Manchester, Cocoa Beach, Denmark, Serbia, Chicago, Belgium, Netherlands, Texas, New Brunswick, Canada, New York City, Warsaw, Poland, Asturias, Spain, Nashville, Nayarit, Mexico, Las Vegas, Italy, Paris, France, Sweden, Portland, Fargo, Wolverhampton in England, Chile, Nova Scotia, and Austria. Killer, right?
Yeah, man. You know, it's always so amazing because of technology and just the world we're in to just, you know, every day I hear from people just in all these different places I've never been. And the cool thing has been in the last few years, I've been lucky to tour to a lot of new places. So I'm hitting these markets for the first time. And it's like you go and you think no one's going to show up. Nobody knows who I am. And because of, you know, True Fire, because of Instagram, and because of just today's world, I'll play a gig in a country for the first time, and it'll be packed. And that's such a mind-blowing feeling to know people care about what you're doing.
No,
you know?
Hey, every time we do one of these lives, and we've only been doing them now for a couple of years, it just illustrates that point. You know, there's like a community of people who love music, guitar players, bass players. There, you don't have to be a guitar player to tune into these things. People are shouting out from every continent, tuning in from every time zone. And you kind of feel the love and you feel part of a big family, you know.
Absolutely.
The internet has messed up the music business in many ways, but in other ways it has completely put it in a different gear, you know, because it's a world audience now.
Well, and it's certainly made you accessible to people that otherwise would have never found you, you know.
Exactly.
You know, people could send me a message on Instagram or Facebook, and a lot of times they'll get a message back from me right away if I'm online, you know.
Yeah.
And it just could be as simple as, you know, hey, what kind of pick do you use? Well, I answer that question literally 20 times a day, you know, but I couldn't ask Stevie Ray Vaughan that when I was a kid.
No.
You know what I mean? I had to read it in Guitar Player.
No, and Josh is sincere about that. He, you know, he will answer you.
Yeah, my wife is always like, you got to take it back a notch. You can't respond to everybody. It takes up so much of your day.
Yeah.
But then I always feel like, that one time that guy's going to think, oh, Josh is a jerk. He didn't respond to
me. Yeah. Well, you know, it's we've been doing this now for 25 years, and we've seen the transition from the way the music business used to be, and the artists were so detached from their audience, and everything was like mass market, and the label took care of everything. That doesn't work anymore. Mm-mm. Today, it's about developing a connection and a relationship with your fans and peers one at a time, you know?
Well, I'd be kidding myself if I said I didn't know that a large portion of my audience comes from this world, this guitar fanaticism, you know, obsessed with gear, obsessed with guitar, obsessed with learning, obsessed with tone and all these things. And so I like to have those conversations. I'm as nerdy as the next guy.
Yeah.
So I'm happy to have those conversations.
He is nerdy, too. I didn't realize that until during our break. We needed to tweak something on his website. He pulls out his laptop, and he gets right in his website, makes a change, boom. You couldn't have done that 10 years ago. No one could have done that.
No.
The tools we have available to us today are phenomenal. Hey, Tommy, just roll one more track. Pick any other track from Improv Roadmap and just play over it. Let's throw this out as if you were on stage. Someone calls out a tune. Let's see what you do with this.
Okay. Just tell me which one you're playing then.
Slow enough.
Okay.
So I can tell you that while that's the backing track that Josh uses in this course, he didn't play it quite the same way, but he approached it in the same way. He told a story over that track using his vocabulary and his distinct voice.
Well, yeah, I didn't have an agenda. I just played.
Right.
You know what I mean? In the course, we use that track to explain using dynamics. So,
yes.
you know, when I'm discussing dynamics, I'm purposefully going to show you the difference between, you know, digging in, not digging in, changing your volume, changing your picking, all these things to help build a solo dynamically. That time I was just being me with no thought at all, which is the end goal at all times.
Yeah. Do you know Mimi Fox, jazz guitar, phenomenal jazz player. I remember, and she, you know, she's said something that so many great artists have said in similar ways. You know, you study, 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 you practice, 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 and then you forget all about it when you get up on the stage and start to improvise, you know, which is exactly what you've just said.
Well, it's absolutely the truth. I mean, now, the studying, all that stuff you can learn, it only helps make the improvising more interesting.
Mm-hmm.
But you can still say what you need to say no matter what you've got in your pocket, you know?
Exactly.
Absolutely.
So a few more shout-outs. San Jose, Cambridge, Grand Rapids, Finland. I always have trouble pronouncing this. Dubuque, Iowa. Did I say that properly?
I think so.
Ridge Manor, Hong Kong, Croatia, Chesapeake, La Spezia, Italy, Bavaria, Germany, Amsterdam, New Zealand, Japan, Delft, Netherlands, Hanover, Germany. And actually, Anita and David are good True Fire artists and great friends of True Fire from Italy.
Oh, wonderful.
They're tuned in, saying very nice things.
Nice.
And I have to shout out to them because we love them very much. And they just released a new album called Our House.
Nice.
Spectacular. I've got to introduce you. When you do Italy, I've got to introduce you to these two people. They are just...
I will be in Italy in the first week of June.
Will you really?
Yeah.
Where in Italy?
Umbria region.
Okay. I don't know how close that is, but Anita and David, if you're tuned in, please let me know if that's near you.
I'm going for a week to teach, actually.
A week
at a
to
retreat,
teach.
A teaching
well,
retreat.
Well, I would love to get you guys connected. Housekeeping. Number one, we do have over 100 thumbs up so far, so I've got to force you to play one of my favorite tunes, okay? So you're going to be here a little longer than expected, but you know, we're going to get you to the baseball
As long as
game.
We get to the Yankee
Okay,
game.
So I was saying before, Josh broke a lot of records. He did two full courses. He did his photo shoot. We did the introduction scripts, and we're doing this live here. He did it all before basically lunch, and now we're doing the live. So we've got time on our hands to play a bonus, but you'll notice the hat. I think the reason he was so prepared to get this done is because where are you going tonight?
I'm going to the Yankee game. Now, I guess if you live here, it would be a Tampa Bay game, but I'm going to the Yankee
game. No, actually, I have to tell you that it's a Yankee game even here, okay?
Yeah.
So
you kidding? I was supposed to come down and shoot the next course quicker, but we waited till now because this was the next time the Yankees were in town to play
true.
The race.
That's true. And Zach and Tommy got some – I hear you have some decent tickets. And
I heard that. I'm hoping that's
maybe
true.
Maybe going to get there a little early for warm-ups. I don't know. But
I'm hoping that's the case.
I'm thrilled schedule all worked out.
Oh, yeah. Anytime I can get to a baseball game in general, but especially a Yankee game, I'm a happy man.
Okay, so henceforth, be aware that we will be timing Josh's future sessions around the any other team you care to? Red Sox, not so much, right?
Oh, Red Sox?
They actually played last night, I think.
I know they did, yeah.
Yeah, you could have gone there and, you know, gotten into some fist fights or something.
Well, it's funny, you know, I'm not one to always be reading the YouTube comments, but that's one that pops up quite regular because of how often I have this hat
on.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, I love Josh, except for that damn Yankees hat.
Well, I'll tell you, there's nothing more exhilarating than being at a Yankees game at the Red Sox. It gets pretty crazy, and vice versa as well.
Mm-hmm.
You ready to answer some questions?
I'd love to answer some questions.
Okay. All right, so we're gonna try to ask you as many of these questions as possible. So keep your answers tight.
Okay.
Okay. I love your jazzy turnarounds. How do you generate these lines? Triads applies to chord substitutions and tritone sub-triads, or what?
That's a loaded question. You know, okay, as far as those types of things go, the only thing I'm ever thinking is what chord is next and how to connect each chord together. I'm not, like I said, part of what we were talking about with building your vocabulary is being incredibly comfortable knowing that whatever chord arises, I've got multiple things in my bag that I can play in that moment over that chord. What I'm more concerned about is how do I make that thing I'm playing right now connect to whatever chord is next in a specific way. So the turnarounds he's talking about are using things like 2-5-1 turnarounds or a diminished chord or an augmented chord or chromatically connecting chords together. Tritones, sometimes I don't think in terms of triads that often. I'm spelling out chords, but it's more on how do I connect one chord to another. So I quite often think about 2-5-1s and about chromatically connecting chords together, or about using a diminished or augmented chord to create tension going from one chord to the next. Those are the main tools that
Great
I use.
Great answer. So are you, when you say connecting the chord you're playing on with the chord that comes next, by chord tones? Are you targeting chord tones? Are you targeting common tones?
I'm targeting chord tones to land on, but this is more about what comes between the chords, almost. So like going from 1-4 by playing a 2-5-1, or by playing a chromatic passing chord, you know, things like that. That's what I'm thinking. So in your solo, you could... You know, that's me chromatically working my way from one chord to the next or using a turnaround. Now, if you just listen to it in a rhythm way like Freddie Green, think about it like going. It's the same thing. I'm putting those chords in the solo when they're not there in the song. You know what I mean? That's how I'm connecting
so
chords
even
together.
Even though the changes aren't literally doing, say, a 2-5-1,
right,
you're implying, you're playing lines that imply the 2-5-1.
Yeah, because a 2-5-1 only, a turnaround is called a turnaround for a reason. It turns you around into a chord. Mm-hmm. So if you use it to target the chord that's happening next, it can only sound like you meant to do that. You're resolving to the next chord in the song. So it doesn't have to be a full chord played out. You just play through those chords, either with an arpeggio or, you know, by just highlighting the chord tones of those chords and you know, whatever, work your way to that next chord. And then once you land on that chord, I'm not thinking at all. I know, okay, I'm on D7. I can keep playing A blues if we're in A, or I can arpeggiate this D chord or whatever. I can do all sorts of things. That's muscle memory.
Great answer, man. Next question. Do you hear everything you play? Do you hear everything you play in detail and translate it immediately to the fretboard in a totally intuitive way? Or do you also play visually, relying on knowledge to bolster your ears?
No, not visually at all. It's all what I'm hearing. Absolutely. You hear it right before you play it. I know everybody experiences this differently. I've heard some guys say they almost like see colors and they relate colors to tones, like, you know, blue is this and, you know, red is this. And I understand that, like cool or hot, things like that. But I almost see it laid out in front of me. So it's very much reactionary. So the first lick I play, like I said, I'm immediately answering that lick. I'm thinking two steps ahead. So I'm hearing the answers to the lick that are coming out of me in real time. And then I'm also thinking about where I'm headed on the chord-wise in the song.
Give us a quick example of that.
Okay, so, you know, the best thing to do to practice that type of thing and make it so second nature is sometimes not to even play guitar. It's to sing, you know? It's to sit there and go like... So when I hear that lick, I immediately want to go... as an answer, whatever, to lead to the four. So I would sometimes sit there and just scat myself licks and then figure out how to play them. Because inevitably, I would play something sing something that I probably wouldn't have ever played. Da-dum, ba-dum, ba-dum, ba-da-da-da-dum. Like, I probably would have never played. I probably would have never played anything in that timing if I hadn't just sung it right then. So that really helped me develop this conversational style. But yes, it just kind of happens on the fly. But that only comes from all the hours, you know, and building up the muscles.
That really is a really insightful answer and a great question. I think that was from Tom Quayle. Yep. And
Tom.
You know Tom?
One of the best guitar players in the world right there, Tom
there
Quayle.
There you go. What is, I think why that's such a great question is Tom obviously knows that most of us, say intermediate players and beginner players, we rely on visual guideposts. You know, we kind of see things in boxes and whatever, and it helps us get up and running. But at the end of the day, it could also be a real anchor and keep you from getting your playing to the next level.
Well, we've all had these moments, I'm sure you've had them, where you listen to a guitar player and you're so in tune with that guy that when he starts a solo, even though he's improvising, you can hear where he's going. You know what I mean? I remember clearly being a kid and listening to Albert King and knowing if he played that he was going to after it, you know? Or I know, remember clearly listening to the Allman Brothers as a kid, and if Dickie Betts was playing, he was going to end it in some way like that that broke away from the repetitive thing.
Yeah.
And so it lays out that same way for me when I'm playing my own thing, almost like a roadmap. It really feels that way to me.
Great answer, man, and a great tip on how to approach developing your ear and developing your lines. Scat. Right?
Yeah, I mean, even if you're not talking about jazzy or phrasing, just sing something, you know, that it'll give you new ideas without question. Or play a lick and sing it back as an answer, or vice versa. Sing a lick and then play an answer.
Terrific,
you know?
Man.
Yeah.
Another question. You know, from Edward Johns, Josh's playing is immediately recognizable. Do you still have to make a conscious effort to avoid sounding like anyone else, despite your influences? Mm. You know, I know we talked before, you know, you've studied all the great players.
Yeah.
And we all learn from, you know, mentors or the masters.
Yeah.
How do you, you know, how do you get to your own voice despite those influences?
Yeah, we talked about this in the first course, Blue Highways, about honoring your heroes, but then putting them to the side. You know, I'm always going to have a piece of all these guys in my playing. Stevie Ray Vaughan is always there. Jimi Hendrix, Albert Collins, Albert King, B.B. King, Freddie King, Otis Rush, Danny Gatton, you know, Wes Montgomery, George Benson, especially Charlie Parker. You know, these guys, I'm going to have all these guys coming out at all times. But there's a difference between approaching a piece of music or a solo and thinking, I need to play this the way Charlie Parker would play this, and approaching a piece of music and not thinking at all. And that's what we're trying to do. So, yes, I make very conscious decisions over the years to push myself further and further towards the things that I knew that separated me from anyone else. That made, and I don't mean like made me better than anyone else. I mean made me different than anyone else. Made me me. So this guitar, for once, I was not a Tele guy up until about 14 years ago. I was a Strat guy, dyed in the wool, always played a Strat. But I found that when I switched to a Tele full-time, it even further pushed me into this voice that I felt was completely my own and that no one else had. So now it's to the point where I consciously play this guitar more because I know if I pick up a Strat or I pick up a 335, I'm going to get in a different headspace. The second I pick up a Strat, I'm thinking about Stevie Ray Vaughan or Jimi Hendrix or Magic Sam. You know, all sorts of things pop into my head. Or Curtis Mayfield or Buddy Guy. The second I pick up a 335, I can't help but immediately think about B.B. King or Larry Carlton.
Right.
You know, it just happens.
Yeah.
So that makes you play different. And that's the thing. I know when I pick up this guitar, I don't think about anything. So, yes, it's all part of this conscious decision to be yourself and to be me at all times.
Nice, yeah. Man. Let's do one more question and then let's start playing. But before the question, the trivia question for today, I want to give you guys another shot at that. Name the band name that Josh was in when he was a mere 13 years old.
Yes.
That was in Florida too, wasn't it?
I was in Florida. I grew up in Fort Lauderdale, in South Florida. And I was playing gigs all the time at 13.
Yeah, it's a phenomenal story. Anyway, name that band. Click on the link you see right there in the chat. Answer that question, and you're eligible in the drawing. Do not put the answer in the thread. Do not do that, okay? That will reduce the odds of you winning the $100 gift card. And Zach, maybe you can... put this in the chat again. We have a promo code worth 25% off. You can pre-order both of Josh's new courses, and you can pick up Blue Highways if you use this code. I believe it's Josh Live. It'll appear in the chat in just a second. You'd be crazy, man, not to take advantage of that code. Forgive me for this gratuitous advertisement, but... I'm telling you, if you don't already have Blue Highways, Josh's first course, it's a must-have. You got to have it in your library. There's no doubt about that. And we cover a lot of ground horizontally. And then we just demonstrated just three of the many lessons and performances from the edition of Blue Highways Improv Roadmaps, which... whether you're a beginner or a pro, I think you're going to dig that course as well. All right, one more question, then we're going to tell them about In the Jam, okay?
Okay.
I love that In the Jam thing, too. I think you answered this question from Terry K. Can Josh elaborate on playing what he's hearing in time in his head? Is he able to translate it immediately, or is he thinking ahead? And you are thinking ahead to the next chord.
Always thinking ahead.
So,
in Indiana Jones, I've said this before, yeah. And hopefully I didn't say it last time, but when they cut to the scene when he's flying somewhere,
yeah,
and it shows the plane, yeah, and it shows a map with the dots behind, yes, the plane as he travels,
yeah,
that's how it looks in my brain when I'm playing a solo.
Oh, man.
I just see these dots, uh-huh, and I'm following this map.
What a great way to illustrate.
That's how it's... I don't know why, but that's the way it seems to me.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And you answered this one from Romans, who were your big early influences. You're already thinking ahead because you're answering, mm-hmm, questions before they're even asked. Okay?
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, influence, again, it's a never-ending list. It's still today, everything I put on, I've tried
to... Who do you love to listen to today?
Who do I love to listen to? I love Julian Lage,
yeah,
Monster. I love this band, Big Wreck, my friend Ian Thornley, uh-huh, a guitar player and singer, yeah, in that band. Of all the new rock bands, I don't listen to a lot of new music, you know, uh-huh, rock especially,
yeah,
but they're an incredible band. I mean, but I still listen, literally, I listen to Albert King and B.B. King every day of my life, mm-hmm, without question. I listen to Otis Rush almost every day. I listen to Sam Cooke, Ray Charles almost every day, Bobby Bland, Solomon Burke, Wilson Pickett. I mean, I love soul and R&B. But for me, I've tried to, at least in the last 25 years, adopt a personal kind of strict policy of anything that I hear music, I'm going to try to put a positive spin on it. Mm-hmm. Because we always have this initial reaction to a piece of music that we're not familiar with or in a style that we don't quite dig, mm-hmm, of negativity. Mm-hmm. And I found myself 25, 30 years ago being very negative about some things. And I realized, you know what? Other people love this for a reason. Let me look at this, mm-hmm, in a different way and find something positive about every piece of music. And that's the way I still try to listen to music. And it served me well in Los Angeles. In the many years where I made most of my living as a sideman and as a session guy, mm-hmm, being able to find, you know, things I liked about music that I had no interest in, mm-hmm, then helped make me be a better session guitar player.
What great advice, man. You know, it'd be really interesting. This just popped in my head to, you know, For you and other artists, you know, the, you always talk about the importance of listening to music, you know. It'd be very cool to get a hold of your playlist, you know?
Yeah.
Like a playlist of what you listen to or what you're listening to now.
Well, isn't it surprising to you? Sometimes I'll be on the road, and we all know these guys, tremendous musicians, uh-huh. who don't like to listen to music uh-huh. when they're not playing.
Yeah.
When you're riding on a six-hour ride, they don't want to hear music.
Yeah.
They don't, and I can't live in that world.
Yeah.
It's like, it doesn't matter that we just played 3 hours of music.
Yeah.
It's fucking silent right now, and I need to hear some music, yeah. you know?
Like I hear you.
I always want to hear something. Yeah.
yeah. You know, there's sadly a lot of artists become very negative and very jaded and burnt out, you know? And that's when it's time to maybe take a break, you know, because when you lose the passion, when you lose your passion for music,
yeah.
how can you perform at your best, right?
I don't know. All I know is no matter what mood I'm in, yeah. if I'm in the car and someone puts James Brown on, I'm in a good mood.
Absolutely.
Like that.
Instantly. Okay, let's talk about In the Jam. So we talked to you about this. Josh brought in tracks, and the goal here was, you know, Josh said, hey, how about I put together tracks that are very similar to the kind of, you know, feels and keys and tempos of the music that I play when I'm live. We said, that sounds like a great idea. What
right.
better way to get in the jam with Josh Smith? So let's play one, and then we'll talk about what's cool about this course. So if you would, though, because you do both rhythm parts mm-hmm. and solo parts here, pick, how about that B-flat shuffle?
Yeah.
And play do a rhythm pass against just, I think, bass and drums, Tommy?
Yeah, bass drums.
Just play. So he'll, but, you know, in the jam, Josh will perform the entire track playing the rhythm part, but this yeah. is what that would sound like.
Yeah, I'm going to play a little bit of rhythm. This is a B-flat minor shuffle. Mm-hmm. I'm going to turn the Leslie effect on, just to a different sound while I play rhythm on this tune. And this tune is based off a tune of mine called Fulfillment. So it's a B-flat minor shuffle, but with a turnaround that goes flat 3 to major 4, and then back to B-flat.
Cool. So this is a very cool software of ours, if I say so myself. We tried to get as close as we could to kind of a jam session type of a vibe. So with this software, you can change the video angle.
Yeah.
Josh is playing for all 10 of these tracks a complete rhythm part, and then he's soloing over his own rhythm part. You can change the video between either his rhythm playing or his soloing. You can mute any track. You can solo any track. You can jump in if you're a horn player. You could be the drummer and mute the drums out. You can play rhythm to Josh's soloing or solo over his comping. It's a really immersive, interactive way to have a lot of fun jamming. But the real educational gold in this thing is there's also a commentary video yeah. for each track. And you'll hear Josh talk over the entire length of the finished performance and tell you what's going on in his head. You know, the dots he's talking about
yeah.
on the map.
And you're hearing them for both. I did a commentary for both the rhythm pass and the lead pass.
Yeah.
So you're hearing my thought process when playing the rhythm. I mean, even in that two choruses of rhythm right there, I set a stage with the first chorus, and then I almost simplified the second chorus because I'm giving, you know, imaginary room for the soloist who I knew after that first chorus of stating ahead would probably break off into more actual soloing.
Yeah.
So I was reacting to the non-existent solo, but yes, I mean, you'll get my kind of roadmap for both things, what I'm thinking.
And, you know, the stuff that I think is very, very valuable, we, you know, let's say intermediate player students tend to, we're just listening to ourselves and we're not picking up on what's happening in the whole discussion, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you point out, oh, the drummer's doing this, so I'm going to do, the bass player's doing, the rhythm guitar, so.
You'll hear very clearly, I'll make the comment many times on these commentaries. Okay, there I just heard the drummer go to the ride cymbal. So that means we're picking up the intensity of this solo. You know what I mean? This is opening things up. So you've got to open up what you're doing and match the intensity of what's going on in this track. You know, you got to have big ears when you're part of an ensemble.
Right.
Your job is to fit in the ensemble, but also support whatever is going on. So if you're not the soloist, you're supporting somebody else who is, or the singer.
Right. And this is the best format we found to be able to teach that very important skill of listening and reacting to what's going on in the band. So let's roll the track now with your rhythm part and solo over it, please.
All right.
And take as much time as you like.
Okay.
Throughout all 10 tracks, you get a rhythm performance, you get a soloing performance. Can we do one more set of those? I want to squeeze
Absolutely.
As much playing in. And remember, we're at 155 thumbs up, so you're going to have to play my favorite tune.
What is your favorite tune?
They're actually all my favorite. The truth is, I'm going to let you pick whatever you want to play.
All right.
Let's do JB Blues. Do a little rhythm first.
Okay, so this is like a funky James Brown type groove in E flat.
Yeah.
So there's some single note stuff to this. You'll hear. There's no way to explain it. But I'll play a rhythm part, and I'll change it up. I'll play a couple choruses, and then we'll switch and do the solo.
Cool. Here's the rhythm part. Nice. Roll the rhythm track with that and solo over it now.
Cool.
Couple more questions.
Sure.
In fact, a lot more questions. So quick answers. Ready? do you use fake nails for your hybrid picking?
No fake nails. I actually don't like a ton of nail. I don't know if you could see, but they're short. I'm mostly using my fingers, you know, my flesh.
Any key jazz guitar solos that you learned that you found super valuable content-wise for playing through changes?
Yeah, jazz guitar solos. You know what's funny? Guitar-wise, it was more listening to guys play through like soul and R&B changes. You know, guys like Eric Gale mm-hmm. and Cornell Dupree mm-hmm. play over simpler stuff. For jazz, I was always more interested in listening to horn players. I was always listening to Freddie Hubbard and Charlie Parker and Lee Morgan and Coltrane and Miles mm-hmm. and guys like that. But as far as like key solos to learn, any Charlie Parker, obviously, first and foremost. For guitar guys in jazz, Kenny Burrell was a guy that was always relatable to me mm-hmm. because a lot of the tunes were blues changes, rhythm changes, mm-hmm. or minor changes, some modal stuff that just hung on a minor chord. Mm-hmm. So I spent a lot of time on Kenny Burrell stuff.
Cool. Thelonious Monk, what's up?
Thelonious Monk is my favorite writer mm-hmm. in the history of music, you know, mm-hmm. and... you know, his soloing obviously was genius, but his sense of melody and phrasing and time was just from another planet. You know, these tunes he was writing and then the stuff he would play over these weird changes and weird tunes, no one phrased like that. And he's just was a complete genius.
Genius,
you know?
Man.
Yeah.
Another question was, would you ever consider doing, you know, an album's worth of more jazzy type of music?
Well, I do have an album that's much more jazzy called mm-hmm. Still. Mm-hmm. It's the most jazzy record I've ever done. Mm-hmm. But I will say that I'm in 2 weeks tracking a new record mm-hmm. that will be now the most jazzy record, but in a different way. Mm-hmm. Kind of like Benson-y and West Montgomery, but mm-hmm. meets big band. It's going to be a big band
really?
Record. And yeah, I'm actually really excited about it. I don't want to
writing the tunes.
I wrote
it?
All the tunes along with a friend of mine named Calvin Turner, bass Ooh. Player, and it's going to be me, Calvin Turner, Lamar Carter, and the great Larry Goldings on organ, mm-hmm. with a 14-piece big band horn
Holy
section.
Holy mackerel! So, the answer to your question, I don't know who asked that, but whoever asked that, there's your answer.
But get Still if you don't have Still. It's quite jazzy.
Yeah, and you know. I didn't mention it yet, but Josh's website is joshsmithguitar.com.
Yep.
Go there now, and you have a sign up an email list or something?
Absolutely.
Get on that list. I've noticed a lot of people, you know, are saying that I only came across Josh recently and love his style, amazing guitarist, you know, thanks to the internet and, you know, this growing world family of music and guitar lovers, you know, we're discovering new people all the time. And, you know, we're very excited to be working with you and consider
likewise.
You know, you're one of a small group of players that's really kind of leading the charge for, you know, it almost defies style. And I know you get thrown into a blues bag all the time, but, you know, it's much larger than just blues, the music that you're making, you know?
It's funny, you know, I get that question, obviously, almost that's one of the most questions I get in an mm-hmm. interview is how do you define yourself or, mm-hmm. You know, and it's hard for me because in my heart, I am a blues guy mm-hmm. through and through. Mm-hmm. It's what I love, you know, the most. I'm never happier than when someone counts off a shuffle mm-hmm. and just go, or mm-hmm. slow blues. But like you said, I love so much music, and I have put in a lot of time and effort mm-hmm. into learning things, you know. Mm-hmm. But I think the main reason I learned all this stuff is, number one, just because that's part of my personality, and I want to know everything. And then number two, I think it makes me a better blues player, which is always my main goal, is to be the best, like, at expressing my, you know, like I said, like we've been talking about this whole time, expressing my true story.
Yeah.
Well, blues guys do that better than anybody in the whole world, expressing themselves through their instrument with a solo. So everything that I learn, no matter how harmonically sophisticated or technically difficult or any of those things, I'm always trying to filter it through this lens of how does it work for me mm-hmm. in furthering my goal of mm-hmm. telling my story as honestly as possible.
Yeah, and you know what, you know, we kind of have this interesting perspective. We see a lot of players come in, a lot of the older players are, you know, they stick to their bag and they stick to it very, very well. A lot of the younger players like yourself have been influenced by so many different genres, you know.
Mm-hmm.
We hear jazz in your playing, a little country in your playing.
Absolutely.
There's a little southern rock in your playing. There's a lot of funk. There's a lot of rhythm and blues. There's a lot of soul. How do you, you know, what seems to be happening is, you know, the genres that radio stuck everything into, and that you'd go in a record store and there'd be the blues.
Yeah.
You know, maybe in 10 years, you won't be able to do that anymore. You know,
well, the problem is a lot of these audiences that have built up these walls mm-hmm. between genres mm-hmm. are now being aged out. Mm-hmm. These audiences didn't allow the music to grow. So now as they're aging out and not attending these shows anymore, mm-hmm. then that audience just doesn't exist anymore.
That's right.
And the people that are showing up now are, you know, I'm not stupid. When I look out in my audience, when I go on tour in Germany or UK or wherever, mm-hmm. it used to be 15 years ago, 90% middle-aged people mm-hmm. or older, mm-hmm. you know, because that's the blues crowd, mm-hmm. which is fine. Now, it's way more than half young guitar players. And they're not coming there because they like how I interpret Muddy Waters mm-hmm. or that I'm so strict in my blues,
right.
you know, staunchness, whatever.
Yep.
No, they're coming there to hear me do what I do. And they're incredibly open-minded and willing to hear that.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a, you know, it's a wonderful blessing, but also a shame that it's so difficult to get the purists to even open up their minds a little bit. Jazz guys have been dealing with it for their whole lives. You know,
sure.
guys, when bebop came out, everybody before bebop hated bebop. And when Coltrane came out,
yeah.
bebop guys hated Coltrane,
sure.
you know? So it's the same thing in blues and all this stuff, you know?
Yeah, it's just a natural, you know, paradigm shift. There's always going to be a little bit of resistance, and then there's going to be early adopters. But, you know, there's a renaissance going on in music today, largely due to the fact that, you know, maybe artists aren't selling records, so mm-hmm. radio is different, and, you know, the stores are different. You're free to do whatever it is that you want to do. You guys, you know, most of you are funding your own albums, doing whatever the heck
Absolutely.
You want to do.
Yeah.
And doesn't that freedom lead to sparking creativity?
Absolutely. You're not concerned anymore about, you know, making this record company or somebody happy, because that doesn't even exist anymore.
Right.
My stuff's not going to get played on the radio.
Right.
You know what I mean? I'm not even worried about that.
Right.
I'm worried about just playing the best that I can and playing the music that excites me.
Right.
And then, yes, I'm taking stock of what seems to get more attention from my fans. What do they like that I do more than other things? You know, but they're also more open to, like I said, to me crossing these boundaries and adding these things together. You know, and it is a generational thing. You know, you've got guys now. I've got younger guitar players who, you know, I've been producing a lot of records lately. So I've been producing for guys who have big followings, younger guitar players than me, who to them, I'm an older guy. You know what I mean? Even though I'm not 40 yet, you know? And, you know, but they come from this different world where they had access to me from the time they started playing when they were 16.
That's right.
And they've seen me and Matt Schofield and Kirk and Robin Ford and these guys.
Yeah.
Whereas Matt and myself and Kirk, we grew up like, if we wanted to learn something about Robin that I couldn't get off the record I owned, I had to order that record and wait for it to show up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to get Inside Story, which was Robin's first record that he played before the Yellow Jackets were called the Yellow Jackets.
Yeah.
I had to order that record at my Peaches record store, which no longer exists, and wait for it to come in the mail.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there was no going on YouTube or anything. I couldn't find this record. There wasn't sheet music for it. There wasn't anything.
Mm-hmm.
So I was way more invested in that record when it finally showed up that I listened to it 8 million times, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Whereas, I'm not saying guys don't value it the same as we did, but it's just a different generation. These guys don't even have, you know, my son the same. My son's 14 years old. He'll never own music in general. He'll never have a record collection.
Right.
He'll stream everything for the rest of his life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's a big difference between you value things more when you had to go save your money to buy it and find a physical place to stick it in your room and you looked at it every day, you know? Yeah.
And at the same time, now that music is exercising the creative freedom, they're free from the producer in the studio, free from the label, free from what's going to be a hit song or get airplay. These younger generations who are streaming are also exposed to a lot of different styles of music. And, you know, it'll be interesting to see where it all nets out in 15, 20 years, right?
Yep.
But keep doing what you're doing.
I got no choice.
Yeah.
This is all I know how to do.
Let's do a couple more shout outs, a couple more questions, and then I'm going to let you pick whatever tune you want to play.
All right.
San Diego, Madrid, Scotland, South Carolina, Kolkata, India, Cornwall, UK, Kingston, Washington, Sydney, Australia, Taiwan, Pittsburgh, Brisbane, Brazil, Roseburg, Oregon. Amazing, right? I think we've probably hit just about every continent. Just about
sounded
every
like
time
it.
Zone.
Yeah.
A couple of quick questions. What's the best approach for outside playing?
The best way to get started with it is, like I said, start connecting the chords. I don't think it's so much as outside playing. That's not the way that I describe it in my head. I think of it as playing, you know, like I said, through the changes, not over the changes. To me, that's a different thing.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of guys say, are you playing over the changes? Of course you are. Like I said, you know a bunch of things to play over each chord. So when that chord arrives, you're cool.
Mm-hmm.
It's connecting them together. So take out a piece of paper, write out 12, if it's a blues, write out 12 bars, just slashes, and fill in each bar with at least two chords, maybe four, one per beat, you know, and start looking at that go by. So if you take a blues, you know, and you've got something like you take this, write all that in, or write it then the second time where when you get to the four, you go to four minor, and when you get to the 2-5, instead of going to the five, you go up to the four minor, you know, and write it differently every time. Or it doesn't have to be a blues. Sit down there and write out. And anything, right? You know, a B flat major 7 to A minor. And then I used to just look at the piece of paper and stare at it and play until what I did made sense. So like that blues, I can still hear it right now, the one I just played. And I would just go... So I filled out every chord that no one's playing beneath me, but I just remembered what I played, or I looked at it on a piece of paper, and I started connecting those dots, you know?
Killer, man. Diminished. Use of the diminished scale. And some people would consider that outside playing.
Yeah.
How would you just give us a quick tip on using diminished scale in the context of a blues?
Okay, so... just listen to this, right? Say we're on the four chord. We're still in that A. And we get to the four chord, which is a D, right? You've heard this a million times. Right? Your mind, your ear wants to hear. It wants to hear that resolve, right? So do that in your playing. If you're going to go... and another thing is a lot of guys don't think as much diminished. You know, everybody knows you can move these diminished chords around in minor thirds, right? But not enough guys do that in their soloing, you know? So when you get to that four, move the lick around in minor thirds. Find new ways, and then you'll, you know, wherever you end... you know, you play an A wherever you end up in any position, you know. That'll help you learn your fingerboard better. But think of diminished chords completely as a way to create tension between other chords. That's the way that I think of diminished chords, as a way to build a bridge from one chord to another, just like I use a 2-5-1 turnaround. It's made to make you land somewhere.
Yeah, that's a priceless lesson you gave us in this live and in your courses about not just thinking about the target note you're going to resolve to, but what's happening in between those two chords to connect them.
That's the biggest difference between, you know, the jazzer and the rocker.
Yeah, yeah.
The rocker knows all this, a million things to play over every, you know. Yeah. They're melodically going to spell out these chords and play beautiful stuff.
Yeah.
But a jazz guy... doesn't take a breath. Well, he does, but I mean, he doesn't panic, sweating, putting chords together.
Right.
He seamlessly makes this motion happen,
yeah.
you know, connecting these chords together. So think of it really like that, playing through the changes, not just over the changes.
Great answer, man. Okay, let's... housekeeping. Don't forget, Josh Live's good for 25% off Blue Highways. You got to pick that one up, and you can also... pre-order both of the courses Josh shot this week, Blue Highways Improv Roadmaps, and In the Jam with Josh Smith, Blue Highways. They're both available for pre-order now. I'm going to let you pick any of the tunes from either of the courses.
Oh, all right.
And play this bonus one. We're at 206 thumbs ups. We really, really appreciate it. And by the way, we have a winner. The Rapscallion answered correctly along with everyone else who did. And the correct answer to the trivia question, the first band name was?
The Rhino Cats.
There you go, 13 years old, right?
Go I don't know what a Rhino Cat is, and I didn't know what it was then. I didn't pick the name.
Well, I'm not sure I know what it is, but it's not a bad name either, you know? But when you go to Josh... smithguitar.com. Read that bio. It's really an incredible story. You know, you had what a wonderful foundation, you know?
You know, and I mean, yes, I'm so grateful for the amount of just hours that I've been able to put in, you know, first having my parents, you know, enable me to do these things. And then my wife, you know, allowing me to continue to do this as a career and support me until, you know, it started to actually make sense financially. It took a long time, you know.
Yeah.
I've been lucky to put my whole life into one thing, you know. And that's the one bonus that I've had, is knowing what I wanted to do since I was a young child.
Well, you know, that's the brass ring, isn't it? Because you obviously, and I can tell you, you know, off camera, Josh loves what he does. He's got terrific passion for it.
It's just so fun.
Yeah.
Music is just such a great thing. And this instrument, you know, is, number one, it's brought me everything in my life that is good.
Mm-hmm.
And number two, still nothing, when I'm down, if I pick this thing up and sit on my couch by myself, within 5 minutes, everything changes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my mood is completely different. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just, this is for me, this is a miracle worker, you know?
Yeah, and you know, I have to tell you that, and I'm going to ask you, well, my own question. I would say that for those of us that are doing something else, you know, 12 hours a day, have families, have other responsibilities, and don't have the luxury of, you know, spending hours with the instrument, that same thing happens for us. We pick up that guitar for 15 minutes or 30 minutes, and everything else goes away.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's just a beautiful thing, you know? So my question to you is, given that we might only have 15 minutes or 30 minutes a day, or maybe just a few days a week even,
yeah,
what would you recommend us practicing or working on during that short amount of time?
The best thing to practice, you know, obviously besides if you have specific goals you want to reach, there's no half-assing it, no shortcuts. You got to just do the work, right? But it's super important to do it in a way that keeps you motivated and excited. So it's like, if you only have 15 minutes, that's not enough time to have some serious lesson that minute. So why not just sit down and learn a song that you love? You know what I mean? If you love Michael Jackson, learn a Michael Jackson song you never learned. If you love the Beatles, learn a Beatles song that you never learned. You know, you may know it by heart already, but maybe you never sat down and figured it out. Nothing gets you more thrilled or excited as to when you learn a song you love that you never knew, you know? And that will inspire me for hours and days sometimes. So it's important to spend times on the things that really get your motor running, you know? Because the happier you are when you pick up the instrument, the more hard work you'll put in.
That's good advice. And, you know, do you... most of us like to put on, you know, a jam track and noodle over it or whatever. Is that... how can you make that process more constructive?
Always play. See, jam tracks are good because it gives you a purpose. It just doesn't give you this mindless meandering of, you know, playing scales or blowing by yourself, just noodling, you know? But even if you don't have a jam track, play always in time. Tap your foot no matter what. Have an imaginary groove or song or chord progression going when you're practicing improv. Don't just be playing for the sake of playing. Be playing in time. No matter what it is, make it up on the fly, but have some sort of time going on, because playing in time, you know, is the key to, you know, really finding, you know, you if you want to be a competent professional type musician, you got to be able to not just play metronomically in time, but you've got to have some time in here. And so don't ever take a break from that. You know, when I sit down to noodle and just go, I don't do that. I go, or it may be, it's always some groove in my head, you know? I might not even state it beforehand, but something is going on in my head so that I can tap my foot and kind of play with a purpose.
Great advice, man. I also have to reiterate something that you said earlier, if any of you missed it, this notion of you don't even have to play the guitar, sing something, scat something, and then try to play it and, you know, kind of... explore the boundaries outside that visual map that's in your head and the muscle memory. I thought that was golden advice as well.
Or learn somebody else's melody that's not a guitar player.
Mm-hmm.
Listen to an Aretha Franklin tune, mm-hmm. and learn to play her melody mm-hmm. on guitar.
Right.
You know, I do that quite often.
Great. All right, man, you get to pick my favorite tune, since I've said they're all my favorite tunes.
All right.
You can pick anyone you want.
Well, give me that train time, Tommy.
And that's off of the...
This is in the jam,
right?
This is a train time beat, kind of a country boogie-woogie in the key of G. I like it because there's a lot of open strings.
Cool.
And I can just have a good time.
All right. You're going to play us out. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in today and sticking with us. I know we ran over, but you seemed engaged. I certainly was. Josh, thank you, man.
Yeah, you're
welcome. There's still plenty of time. Don't worry. You're going to make the Yankees. Not a problem.
I'm not worrying.
Two phenomenal courses. Take advantage of that promo code, joshsmithguitar.com. Get on his radar screen. The big things to come. I can't wait for the new album. And with that, let's jump on the train.
All right.